Next up, we have Susan Lemus. She is a writer, a poet, a teacher, with the UCLA Extension's Writers Program. She received her MA from Fresno State and also is a co-founder of the LA Poetry Festival with Sherman Pearl. She is a recipient of the 2015 Beyond Baroque's George Julie Smith Award and has written 3 books, In Danger, Idiosyncrasies, and Open 24 Hours, which also won the 2013 Blue Linux Prize for Poetry. And I recently learned she has an extensive knowledge about the history of the Poet Laureate. So welcome, Susan.
I also would like to thank Jefferson and all of the masterminds behind the Larry Levis Scholarship, right? Which are raising money for here tonight. And my teachers, I want to thank my teachers. There's Peter Everwine over there, who taught me so much. There's Chuck Hanselcheck, who taught me so much. And Fran Levine, representing the immortal presence of Philip Levine, who I think whose spirit remains with us as an inspiration for his stunning work. Now, I'm gonna overlap with Kenneth a little bit. In a few ways. In fact, I was sitting there thinking I'm gonna switch out my program a little bit because you gave me some ideas. For a long time, I lived in East Hollywood, not the fashionable, not the wealthy part of Hollywood, the down and out part of Hollywood. Naturally, that's where I'd land. And I lived in a four-story brick tenement with a fire escape down the front, right on Vermont Avenue. Well, it was never quiet on Vermont Avenue. You could wake up any time of night and there were sirens coming down the street and activity on the street. And another thing that happened in that particular building is whoever wanted to crash their car, they came to 1175 North Vermont and crashed the car. It was sort of a car crash central. And after a while I learned, for a lot of different reasons, many different reasons, I learned to sleep more or less dressed. Earthquakes, car crashes, people knocking on my door at 2 a.m. And when I opened the door, they would say, "Would you like to buy some tamales?" So therefore, I didn't. Couldn't sleep naked in that situation. So, this was a real one of the many real events that happened, and it's called Hot Pursuit. It wasn't just the grind of brakes, cry of metals, unforgiving each other. No, it was that delirious and slow plowing headlong into and past traffic light, street lamp, then the disruption of parked truck that got me out of bed and down 4 flights of stairs onto the street. The rubble of smashed glass makes the sidewalk shine, the traffic lights lying knocked flat. One cop car stopped behind the spot. The others in pursuit. The kid hit the ground and took off 5 foot. Everyone's drained out of the donut shop, the Armenian dance hall, owl drugs, homeboys in t-shirts and blue tattoos. In LA, it gets like this at night. Hot. We stare at the parked truck that got punched from the back, then at the criminal car. Under the flung hood, the motor stamps and steams. "Look at that bumper," we yell, "that twisted wheel," and the glove compartment sprung, so the deeds of legal ownership drift out the driver's side, the driver's doors bent wild. It's like so ajar, it's like Chamberlain sculptures from crushed cars. here is the art of disaster, the art of the split second, fatal, bad choice. I know how our mistakes change the shape of things, but to look at the twists and turns that kid put in this Ford coupe, you'd think what he wanted really was to make a crazy staircase and climb up. So when I was living in my tenement, and I'm reading some poems from my most recent book called Open 24 Hours, and several of the poems in here come from that time in my life. So I would sit around doing what people do when they don't have a lot of money, is try to come up with good ways to make money. So I came up with all these ways to make money. None of these were really very good when I went to the list. This doesn't sound too promising. So I have my a series of poems called Ways to Make Money 1, Ways to Make Money 2. All right, this is Ways to Make Money 1. We will wash your cat. Your budgie, your small, untidy, unlicensed tree-dwelling beast from Tanzania. We will walk your spaniel, your grandma, smooth the specks from her spectacles, prop her against a sturdy surface like a liquor store, let her stare at the view. We will write some poems for you for your birthday, which everyone forgets, not us, or we will write your poems. We can make them rhyme. Look, from sea to shining sea and from the shores of Tripoli, or pay us in advance for when your time comes. Let a poet write your obit. We will fix your broken stuff. We own glue. We will guard your guard dog. We will wash your car. We will remove from your windshield the cheap business cards, Bible quotes, news of parts store openings, little cries for help cast on the waters, all the slips of rained on fading paper, including this one. And this second one of ways to make money, I dreamt this way of making money, and it's in the dream it seemed this is such a great way to make money, and for about a minute after I woke up, and then I went, oh no, it's a terrible way to make money. Okay, so it's called Ways to Make Money 2, or Rent Your Indie Mom. Okay, one. Sad boy, you never had the mom you wanted. Rent our 1960s counterculture mom. She'll stitch and knit and macrame your clothes and chew leather till it's soft to shape sandals for your precious feet. You'll catch your first brain swamp concert just before they switch from light to heavy metal at 12 days old. She'll need no man but you. She'll rock you in her arms along with everything she swears she knows is true, that you'll grow up to be a successful, happy man. The sky will shower blessings shaped like tiny birthday cake rosettes, and soon, no more war. Two, sad and cheated boy, your mom wasn't what you hoped for. Rent our traditional 1950s mom apple pie. Oh, the delight of peeling back thin foil to reveal three white slices, protein floating in its tray of pale gravy, then the patch of yellow kernels, then boiled sugared apples with some dough, and yes, the miracle of TVs on, an old man delivering the news, then cowboys, and tomorrow a trip downtown. She'll take your tiny hand in hers and drag you red and howling away from department store displays filled with every gleaming, shining, candy-colored thing you ever wanted and still can't have. I'm glad something amusing came out of my poverty. I have a question. Does anybody here, I left LA several hours ago, leaving behind something I really wanted, which is my copy of Larry Levis's The Fish. Does anybody, he's reaching in his pockets. Do you have Larry Levis's The Fish? Oh, you could Google it for me. Oh, because I love that poem so much. See, I always forget about these little devices. I don't believe they exist. Okay, he's going to work on it. Okay, so I'm going to go to it's a little bit of a darker, edgier mood. Most of my work is a little edgy. And I wrote a series of poems inspired by, this is what happened to me. It was back when video had just come out. It was a miracle. You could own a movie. This was unthinkable when I was growing up. I mean, only the wealthiest people in the land had a movie theater. So I decided to just stay inside. I dropped out for about 4 days, stayed inside, watched video, and I ate fortune cookies. And at the end, I was in a hallucinatory state. It was like a dream quest where they would go into the forest and they would until they had a vision. So I had some visions, and they were that if I picked up all these little slips now scattered all over the place of fortunes, that I could make each one the title of a poem. And I actually wrote these first three or four poems in a very altered state of mind. How are we doing on The Fish, meanwhile? We're working on The Fish. I think it's in there somewhere, though. All right, so this one, has anybody ever gotten the one, Take That Chance You've Been Considering? You've gotten Take That Chance You've Been Considering? I get that one, too, periodically. So,
it starts with, the cop holds me up.
Yes!
Like a fish.
I'm just going to read that. I have to read that.
It's very small, I'm sorry.
It's okay.
Okay.
I hope.
Okay.
Yeah, I think I can see it. But don't go too far away, because it might disappear on me. Okay, this happens to me with these devices. Okay. This is this is a beautiful poem. All right, and an early Larry Levis poem, and it is, to me, one of the great poems of that era. And it's a poem that just keeps getting better as time goes on, and more relevant as time goes on. Fish. The cop holds me up like a fish. He feels the huge bones surrounding my eyes, and he runs a thumb under them, lifting my eyelids as if they were envelopes filled with the night. Now he turns my head back and forth gently until I'm so tame and still, I could be a tiny plastic skull left on the dashboard of a junked car. By now, he's so sure of me, he chews gum and drops his flashlight to his side. He could be cleaning a trout while the pines rise into the darkness, though tonight's trout are freezing into bits of stars under the ice. When he lets me go, I feel numb. I feel like a fish burned by his touch, and turn and slip into the cold night, rippling with neons and the razor blades of the poor and the torn mouths on posters. Once I thought even through this, I could go quietly as a star, turning over and over in the deep truce of its light. Now I must go on repeating the last filthy words on the lips of this shrunken head, shining out of its death in the moon until trout surface with their petrified round eyes and the stars begin moving.
Wow.
wanna read my poems. Really, I really think that is one of the great contemporary poems. So I'm gonna read a different thing. I've decided I've just changed my mind. I'm gonna go to a different place. I'm still gonna read the poem I introduced, because after all, I did spend all that time introducing it and the fortune cookie things. But I'm gonna, this, Kenneth, this also, I also got this idea from you, because you were talking about the helicopter. So one time, this is a very dark poem. So everybody has to fasten your, I guess you have to fasten, do you have to fasten your seatbelts for a dark poem? Put out your galoshes, I don't know what you have to do for a dark poem. But this was on one of these occasions, but there's been helicopters, a lot of helicopters in East LA, but this time the helicopter just starts circling, circling, circling the building, but around and around, and getting closer and closer, and each time it passed my single apartment, the beam would flash right across my room, and it just went on and on, and then I began writing this poem while this was happening, and it is called Poem Noir. Light rakes across my window with that sound we call chop, chop, then circles back. It's keeping this place under wraps, winding, winding in a sticky thread, the bad and the good. Seems someone used a gun in a crime again, then ran home. And last night cries from the street, so I looked out, but it was empty, hell, just beat down rain, bunkers of concrete lodged like crude ships that sank, and the bulb lit sign, goodwill. But whenever I'd been mugged, it wasn't here. Near Fairfax once, the gun against my head made a tiny pricking sound like a watch, or like a click inside a watch, that pin drop we can't hear between the tick and the tock. It burnt my imagination, woke it up. But I've got stories worse than that. Two assholes dragged me off the street like I'd have seen them coming right, but I was checking my makeup under a light. What went down, this rhymes, was not a pretty sight. There's things I can't tell, even in poetry. You understand that? Anyway, so what? A cool beam sweeps into my room, then circles up. But I was born in 51, see, that far back. And still, no cops had to trace in dime store chalk the outline of my shape where I stopped, leaned forward, not because I'd spotted my name in cement, then knelt on one knee, not because I was searching for something I'd lost, then two, not because I was praying, then sat, not because I was suddenly tired of all this, then lay. Okay, now everybody's depressed. Okay, now you're depressed. This won't help that much. Okay, all right, back to Take That Chance You've Been Considering. I'm over the railing now, down below the gray blue winks and the light and wrinkles up. To me, it seems like the no land between fact and fiction, lies and the elusive truth. But don't trust my take on it. I'm in a state. Trust me, says the official in so many words after he's inched as close as he dares without pushing me, you know, over the edge. Hey, what seems to be wrong? Wow, what a leading question. But, oh, I do trust him. I do. Look, I want to say, the sky is the exact untroubled blue of the crayon I picked once years back to make the sky blue. And the broken parts of this world are so far off that from here, they're cracks in the sidewalk. Deep down, though, I'll bet the sea's fingering the bones of jumpers, rolling them like old ideas that never quite took. What do you think? Oh, but I can't say that. He'd conclude I was mad. The police have drawn a line the cars can't pass. It's a nice day, he says. Good day to talk. We can work things through. Want a hand? I mustn't speak. Just smile politely as if to say thank you. Or fine, you? From where I stand, people look like ants. That is, their hearts like the nipping heads of red ants. I can't explain this. But suddenly, I want a bigness like the sea or sky, a largesse, an inheritance, the full embrace. I want to take that chance I've been considering. Stranger, isn't it true, isn't it, that out of every 1,999,999 drop straight toward the obvious, but one flies? I think I will close with another fortune cookie. And has anybody ever gotten the one, "The Nightlife is for You"? It's a popular one. I've gotten that about 3 times. It really is for me. Okay. All right. "The Nightlife is for You." Here on the boulevard of run-amok dreams, each stamped with a doll-like face you half recognize as yours, the neon displays its chilly, self-possessed light. But the lips on the billboards are raspberry cream. They say, "Buy me," or "Be me." You can't tell. You're confused like mad again in this night of mixed blessings, spiked with a ripe curse, that line you fall for every time. You'll drive these streets in a trance after your death, crying, "I'm still here." But now you get out and walk. This pale, feverish presence inside your life is you, and those are loud strangers gripping beers. But why die ever while stores shout out their bargains, hot CDs, and one can gaze at the bodies who've stopped dancing now and stand about jaggedly because the doorways of rock clubs pump them into open air. No doubt about it, all this is for you. Some doo-wop tune on the airway says the night's thousands shifting eyes are on the watch. You guess two of them are yours. Tonight, Mr. Good or Bad might pluck you from the crowd. There's some place you're supposed to be, some fun you're supposed to have. It's fate, your fate, and it's open